Hi, welcome to How to D&D. My name is Fred Weller, and today I want to talk about Dungeons & Dragons. But I'm not talking about Dungeons & Dragons 5e, I'm going to talk about the Monster Manual for Dungeons & Dragons 4e. Now, I've had this book for a long time, I used all the monsters in this book, and of course it's pretty impressive. It's got Orcus on the front, so let's have a look inside. I'm also going to flip it over so you can have a look at the back, just see what it's like. One of the things that I find with these monster manuals is I always find myself wanting to pick them up simply because of the pictures inside. Now, if you haven't figured it out, I actually love monsters, and probably why I do a lot of dungeon mastering in my games, and hence why I tend to buy all the monster manuals when I get an opportunity. So we've got the contents page, and there's probably, I would say, in the vicinity of about 152 monsters and some variations on them. Some very nice artwork to begin with. And then it sort of breaks it down. It covers how to read the stat blocks in the first couple of pages. And of course, this is a game that was designed to be played by new people and designed to deal with a new market. And it's literally been codified so that everything is supposed to be much easier and quicker for a dungeon master to play and run in their game of Dungeons & Dragons. So we've got a lot of angels to begin with. It shows how the build a encounter can be done. It sort of gives you some samples. Each of the pages usually have a section, so right here there's a section that shows you some sample encounters that are pre-built for certain levels of play, which I consider that to be vastly overcomplicated and rather forced. Not really something that I really enjoyed. Not really logical. Sometimes the combination of monsters doesn't seem to make sense. But we've got the basilisk in here, which is why I like it. I've used this picture a few times in my games. And of course, we've got fire bats. This is where we are introduced to variations on monsters. There's lots of variations. And types of monsters. So, monster types are supposed to be streamlined in this particular version of the game. We get some beetles and dinosaurs, but how do they streamline them? Oh, we got to stop for the... This is the Beholder. Obviously one of the key monsters in Dungeons & Dragons that's iconic. Great piece of artwork. Although it does have flavours of being a bit cartoonish at times. If you sort of have a really close look, it does look a little bit cartoonish. And you can see huge stat block, but not a lot of fluff, which is a little bit concerning. I'm going to keep flipping through here. So I was talking about the streamlining of monster types. And the monster types that have been streamlined down to the controller, the lurker, the brute, the artillery unit, the skirmisher, and the soldier. And this was all supposed to make it much easier for a dungeon master to run the game of Dungeons & Dragons 4E. Carrion crawlers, really iconic monster, and of course the chimera, or is it chimera, who knows, well, it's chimera. The design concept behind Dungeons & Dragons 4E was that you would have like three or four types of monsters that you would build into your encounter. Cyclops! There's the Cyclops! And this was supposed to make it easier for the Dungeon Master to run their game of Dungeons & Dragons. In fact, it really made it harder. I found it more difficult. Now we're stepping into demons. The Baelor is included. We also got introduced to the concept of solo monsters, which fought on their own, and then of course the minions, which would simply be struck down with one blow. They had like one hit point, they were usually quite hard to hit, and then down they would go. And of course the controllers in this game were really like the spellcasters. They changed the way the battlefield would work. Ah, we have devils, and lots of them, the bone, the chain, all those good sorts of nasty beasties that you would want to have in your game. And of course, with the game of Dungeons & Dragons 4E, we had lurkers, things that would sneak up on their prey. The players had to be very careful, and then of course they would then wreak havoc on them, or supposedly wreak havoc on them. Ah, displacer beast. I always liked the displacer beast. I haven't used a displacer beast very often though. And of course the doppelganger, which we've seen in Dungeons & Dragons 5e. Then of course there were things like brutes, which were just huge bags of hit points that just sort of stayed there and just did not die. I've used the Draklich a couple of times, the Vaults of Draklich. Ran that adventure as an event, I believe, with something like 6 or 7 tables. Was a lot of fun. And then, of course, we get some dragons. There's not as many dragons in this book as I would have hoped, but hey, you get what you get. Then we get artillery units. Artillery units were things that would sort of sit at the back and they would just pummel the players' characters from a distance, and that's all they really did. Skirmishers would jump in and out of combat. They were literally what they were doing, skirmishing. And then, of course, you've got soldiers, and soldiers just held the front line. They weren't really useful for anything else. We're also introduced to the Dragonborn, which is basically a humanoid dragon, and you could use that as a monster or play it as a character. The concept of the minion is actually a really good idea and should have been translated over to Dungeons & Dragons 5e, in my opinion, because they did actually serve a function of slowing things down. You can still do that, but of course they'll have more than one hit point, which makes sense because, of course, not everything is going to have one hit point. Commoners would have one hit point, but not all monsters or creatures will. Certainly some of the smaller beasts do. Solo monsters have never worked well in any game that I know of, and even in Dungeons & Dragons 4E, solo monsters worked better if you used minions or other creatures with them, which is why it was always sensible to make sure you built up your battlefield with a variety of different creatures and monsters. And there is also a tactics section. There's usually a tactics section in each of the monsters, and it's not usually very involved. It's very, very basic, it's very short, and I honestly thought they needed to be much longer than they were. Monster descriptions are way too short. Most of the descriptions weren't enough information to build a story around, so you were just dealing with using pre-made adventures to be able to figure out what was going on, because literally the descriptions were so short. And often they were descriptions of the creature themselves rather than their backstory. You needed a little bit of backstory to be able to use your monsters. I mean, what are we going to do with the ghoul? Is that 2 sentences? I think it's about 2 sentences. The art's nice. I actually thought I rather liked the art, although it doesn't always give you context, so it makes it a little bit hard to build a story around it. I'm not particularly fussy when it comes to artwork, so I would have been happy with pretty much anything anyway. There's usually a monster lore section where you get to roll a few dice, and it stipulates what sort of monster lore knowledge check you would make and what the number or the DC or difficulty class would be, which is always good too. I think there was way too much stuff left out. It felt incomplete at times. And also too, I always wanted there to be a lot more. I didn't need a monster lore section for goblins, as an example, or hobgoblins. What I needed was just enough information that I knew what they were all about. And there just isn't enough here without going and doing a bit of research somewhere else. Even golems, not enough information, not really. Monsters were made up of a whole lot of different things, and their stat block consisted of powers, really. The at-will, which was something you could use all the time. The encounter power, which essentially was use it once per encounter, and that was it. Often based off the concept of playing a character. And then, of course, daily uses, where you could only use it once a day. And then, of course, you got the recharge feature, which was often for really big powers or creature effects that you might use in your game. This monster manual is not the monster manual I was expecting or hoping for, but I'm fine. If I got monsters, I got monsters. And Hooked Horrors, I always liked the artwork. Just sitting and strumming through and looking at the different creatures was always fun. I felt like there were way too many different humanoids in here. The Hydra, I've used a Hydra before, but as you can see, it's very sparse on tactics or even information on the Hydra, so you've really got to go and do a lot of research to be able to sort of benefit from using this book. I think that's probably part of the reason that Dungeons & Dragons 4E was not as popular or successful as it should have been. The Kotoa, nice picture, a stat block, but not enough information or juice. I mean, when I looked at this book, I sort of missed having my advanced Dungeons & Dragons monster manual. And like a fool, the Lich is underpowered. I always thought Why did I do that? Why did I give away my advanced Dungeons & Dragons Monster Manual? It had so much really cool stuff in there, and now I have this. And of course, I didn't run 3.5 or 3 as a Dungeon Master. I played it, so I had the Player's Handbook, but I didn't grab anything else. The Medusa. So there's plenty of really iconic monsters, the Mind Flayer, all the things you might want. It did leave out a few things. Minotaurs, I like Minotaurs. And actually the write-up for the Minotaurs is actually quite extensive. All of the things you might want. But what you really want is the guts, the lore, the story behind the monster, the things that would really sort of help tie it into your adventure. How to build your own adventures. You could literally build your own adventure with just the Monster Manual and nothing else. You didn't even need the Dungeon Master's Guide. But with this book, it was much more difficult. And I always found myself falling back onto the fact that I didn't have enough information to run my adventures. The prime selling point for this particular book is Orcus. It provides you with some description, some lore, a stat block, and a really impressive piece of artwork, which is essentially duplicating what you see on the front cover. Now, I'm not saying that this book isn't good in its conception. It was trying to do something that had never been done before. The owlbear. Yes, the owlbear. But it didn't work out. And so nothing sort of really sort of felt right. Our monsters, particularly at higher levels, just didn't feel powerful enough. And I will forgive them the fact that they didn't have what I was hoping for. The Roper, a monster that is well known, but how it works in this particular version of the game, I still think I prefer the 5th edition version of the Roper. And I keep these books. Why did I not get rid of these books? I keep these books because there's a little bit of information. It does have a bit of tactics in it. I keep it mostly for the pictures. And also too, I'm always thinking, well, will I ever go back and play this game? I don't know that I will go back and play this game. The Skull Lord, which is supposed to be showing up in a new printing, the Tome of Mordekainen's Tome of Foes, is supposed to be having the Skull Lord in it, which will be really useful in a game, because if you are using skeletons and then you would run a Skull Lord of all things, yes you would. One of the things that is a bit frustrating about the Dungeons & Dragons 4E game was the book included a lot of variations which were supposed to be used at different levels. So at low level and high level, you had different monsters you could use in your game. It didn't really matter what level of play, you could still introduce those monsters. I think that actually was probably the wrong way of seeing monsters. I think there certain monsters were supposed to be taxing and dangerous at certain levels, and then after that they weren't going to be useful to you. And as a result, by using so much of the book for stat blocks, you don't get the meat and the story behind your monster. Vampires, there's just not enough information on vampires. Instead, we have a whole bunch of stat blocks. And of course, if you have a whole lot of variations of a monster, which seems like a really good idea. It seemed like a really good idea. I can use this monster at this level because there's a variation on it and it's staggered. So you could use it low level, mid level, but not so much at high level. This is the one thing that was really annoying for me as I play this game. But I don't have the Advanced Dungeons & Dragons Monster Manual anymore because I was like a fool. I gave it away and I shouldn't have done that. And then, of course, at the back, it's got some racial traits where you can sort of build into your game racial traits. Not so useful, but I think some of the information in there regarding the tactics is really good. It gives you a glossary, so it gives you an idea of how the Monster Manual is supposed to be used. And one of the things that seems to be lost on a lot of 5e books is the concept of having an index at the back of all your monsters by level or by area, which is not included in the Dungeons & Dragons 5e book. So there it is, that is the Dungeons & Dragons Monster Manual for 4e. Now, I will keep this book. I enjoyed this book, and it really was only over time that I discovered that there was so many problems with it. And I will still retain the book primarily for the small amount of tactic information in it, and the fact that it has a whole lot of really cool pictures, but I don't know that I'll ever go back to playing that game, which is kind of a shame. Even the old monster manuals, no matter how old they are, will have some use to you. You just need to go back through them and have a look and pull out the bits that are useful to you right now. If you found this video helpful or informative, please share and like the video. If you like this sort of content, please subscribe to my channel and hit the bell button to be notified when I go live and when I publish a new video. If you want to support my channel, you supported my channel by watching this video. I have 500 more videos plus, and I do one every single day. There's bound to be something as a dungeon master or a player you will find useful at some point. I don't do Patreon, but down in the description you'll find affiliate links to the Book Depository and Amazon, where you can buy stuff online. You pay exactly the same price as you normally would. I get a small commission. It's really helpful to me, and you don't even have to buy the thing that it has been linked to. You just have to go through that link. I'm also an Amazon influencer, so I have a storefront with recommended products that you can go and purchase. If you have any questions about the Dungeons & Dragons 4E Monster Manual, please put them down in the comments. Tell me what did you think of this book, and did this show you the information you really wanted? And hey, till next time, keep rolling those 20s.